Hey everyone, the toxins tournament has ended and thankfully you chose mushrooms to learn about as opposed to something boring like chocolate toxicity. So we are going to discuss mushrooms, more than just a pizza topping. So I think one of the most common questions that people have about mushrooms are which ones are toxic. There is an adage about mushrooms. There are old mushroom hunters, there are bold mushroom hunters, but there are no old, bold mushroom hunters. And basically, what that's telling us is that even people who are experienced in finding and cooking and eating mushrooms really don't know exactly which ones are going to be okay and which ones may pose a real threat to their health. So, as we kind of go through and talk about mushrooms, they are very difficult to identify one species from the next. They have very subtle differences in them. And so your best bet is just to assume that all mushrooms that are out in the wild are probably toxic to your dog. And so just be really careful with having your dog out in areas where mushrooms can be growing. Those of you who live in very arid, dry climates, this is all gonna be really interesting to you. To people who live in an area like Portland, I have mushrooms growing wild in my backyard. Be really careful because some of these toxicities are occurring just in the yard with these dogs eating what's very close to them. So the most common culprit for really bad mushroom toxicities are the Amanita species of mushrooms. These are the Alice in Wonderland mushrooms, so they're really brightly colored. Most of them have this kind of red-pink cap on them, and then they have, on the West Coast, they have little white tufts on them, and on the East Coast, the tufts are yellow. There's also the death cap mushrooms, which are just kind of white and they have gills underneath. Death cap is a horribly ominous name, but it's in the Amanita species. So again, they're the most common culprit for mushroom toxicity. They are really rapidly absorbed from the gut. So as soon as the dog eats these mushrooms, this poison is absorbed very, very quickly. And then it also goes into enterohepatic circulation. So what that means is that the liver is filtering out this toxin, puts it in the bile goes into the small intestines, and then the enterocytes pick up that toxin, recirculate it back through the liver. So it's really just kind of in this endless loop of toxicity causing clinical signs that can last for quite some time. The toxin attacks rapidly dividing cells, so the cells of the GI tract, of the liver, and also of the renal tubules in the kidneys. So you can see where we're going to start to have problems with these mushrooms. It can take about 10 to 12 hours before clinical signs start showing up. So you may have the dog on a hike, eats a mushroom, comes home, does fine, and then start showing signs maybe even the next morning. So there are three phases to the toxicity of Amanita mushrooms. The first phase is GI signs. So they start with vomiting, with diarrhea. Sometimes they'll get abdominal pain, they'll get dehydrated. A lot of times they'll get a fever. We see some pretty significant electrolyte disturbances from all the vomiting and diarrhea. It can be pretty violent, huge amounts of vomiting, just diarrhea everywhere. Everything is moving very, very quickly as it, you know, the body is trying to rid itself of this toxin. Then what's kind of frightening about these is there's a 12 to 24 hour latent phase. So the GI phase lasts 12 to 18 hours, and then there's a latent phase. So you have a dog vomiting diarrhea, and then it starts to feel better, and signs calm down for a day. And this can be where owners think, oh, it was just something they ate, which is true, but they're not going to get over it and move on, because the third sign is the third phase is the hepatorenal phase. And this is actually what I like to call the melting liver. So everything starts to go wrong with these patients. We'll see severely increased liver enzymes. They become coagulopathic, so they can no longer clot their blood and they start bleeding inappropriately. Hypoglycemic from their liver failure. Renal values shoot up, and they will see severe azotemia and sometimes decreased urine production. They can start to show neurosigns, and then usually 3 to 7 days post-ingestion of the mushrooms, most of these patients die. So even with treatment, some of them we've seen in the hospital, we can't say for sure that they've ingested mushroom because we'll see them, you know, sometimes 2 days after they've eaten it, and there's no more sign in their GI system that they've eaten this mushroom. We're just treating these patients for acute liver failure and then they pass away. So very, very dangerous species of mushrooms for them to eat. The trick to treating these guys is to catch them early and to decontaminate them as much as possible. Vomiting induction is a good idea. Even though the toxin is absorbed very quickly through the GI tract, if you can get them to vomit or perform gastric lavage to get as much mushroom out as possible. Activated charcoal, not sure if it helps, but probably doesn't hurt. So every 4 to 6 hours for at least 48 hours, give them activated charcoal. And then you just support them through until their body metabolizes all the toxin that they've eaten. So that is IV fluids, that's blood products as needed to replace clotting factors, to replace lost blood, GI protectants, just really providing as much support for the clinical signs that you're seeing. There's been some work on, you know, looking at acetylcysteine for treating Amanita mushroom toxicity. Again, there isn't any real evidence that says it helps, but there are some people that say it doesn't hurt, so go ahead and try it. So if you're getting desperate, and you know that the animal has eaten Amanita, you can try giving them acetylcysteine. So the next class of mushrooms that we're gonna talk about have musk green in them. And musk green is an agent in little brown mushrooms. So it's a large class of mushrooms, really difficult to identify one from the other, but these are the mushrooms that are gonna be growing in the backyard. So in, you know, dark, cool, damp areas, I believe these are probably the kind of mushrooms that grow in my backyard when I don't mow my lawn often enough. With these mushrooms, you start to see clinical signs within about 2 hours. So pretty quick, again, absorbed very quickly. And the clinical signs are salivation, lacrimation, urination, defecation, sometimes emesis. So that's the SLUD acronym. And what you do for ingestion of this musk green is to first decontaminate, if possible. Most of these animals with the diarrhea that they're having, and oftentimes they're vomiting, they will vomit up what they have eaten. But if they haven't vomited, or you think there may be more, go ahead and induce vomiting. And then atropine is the antidote for this. A lot of these guys will have really, really large pupils. And so when you're treating them with atropine, you want to use their drool or their oral secretions. When that starts drying up, then you know they've had enough atropine. You don't want to give them, you know, you don't want to use their pupils as a sign of how they're doing. You just want to wait until their drool dries up. And the dose of atropine is 0.2 to 2 mg per kg, IV and IM, so giving it as a combination with those guys. Then IV fluids and support. They can get pretty dehydrated with all the vomiting, with all the diarrhea that they're having. I remember treating a dog that had ingested some musk green, and his GI tract was moving so quickly. We were administering charcoal to him, and he was having charcoal diarrhea before I was even done administering it by mouth. So things were just shooting through his body. So really, really dramatic diarrhea with these guys. The psilocybin, this is the last type of mushroom we're going to talk about. These are the magic mushrooms. These are hallucinogenic mushrooms. And people can grow these in their house. This picture here is these psilocybin species mushrooms being grown in a Tupperware container in a house. But they can also be found out in the wild. So with a lot of these cases, people know what type of mushroom the dog has gotten into because they were enjoying it themselves. But we have seen these with dogs eating them out in the wild. Clinical signs for this mushroom can start within a half an hour up to about 4 hours after ingestion. The good news about this is that the signs only last about 12 hours. Anxiety, severe aggression, and seizures are the most common clinical signs that we'll see with these. And again, it's pretty dramatic. These dogs, with their hallucinating, they'll oftentimes be vocalizing inappropriately. They're mentally inappropriate, and you can't really handle them very well because their response to everything is just huge and out of control. In extreme overdoses, we can see patients that are comatose. So just because a patient is flat out doesn't mean he hasn't ingested these hallucinogenic mushrooms. Gastric lavage is probably the best way to decontaminate these guys. They are so mentally inappropriate that anesthesia is the best thing for them to kind of calm everything down and then perform your gastric lavage and then continue with sedation. The clinical signs of these psilocybin mushrooms are similar to serotonin syndrome, with just everything being this really out of control response to what's going on. So you can give them rectal cyproheptadine. I have seen this work. It's amazing to have a dog who is really hyperesthetic and just screaming inappropriately because he's hallucinating. You can crush up the cyproheptadine and then give it rectally, and the body will absorb that, and it kind of tones everything down, allows them to quiet down as they metabolize out this toxin. These patients need to be in a quiet environment, so if possible, kind of putting them in a corner, turning the lights down, putting a towel in front of their cage, just keeping all of the, you know, external stimulus to a minimum for them, and then providing supportive care until they come out of it. So I just want to go over a couple cases that we saw in the hospital here of mushroom toxicity. The first one is Sally. She's a 5-month-old female intact German Shepherd dog. The owner got home from work and let her outside about 12:30 in the morning to go to the bathroom, the yard that she always goes in, fenced in yard. About 1 a.m., so half an hour after being outside, she just got really hyperactive, drooling buckets, and then what I like to call hyperdiarrhea. She was literally spraying the house with this diarrhea. So tosses her in the car, brings her to DoveLewis. He told us that there were known brown mushrooms in the yard, and so that falls into probably the little brown mushroom, meaning musk green toxicity. So she is showing the signs of that: salivation, lacrimation, urination, defecation, emesis. Those are the signs of the musk green toxicity. So on presentation, she had really loud gut sounds. We could hear them from across the room, so stuff moving very quickly through her guts. Really drooly, tense abdomen, not necessarily painful, but I would imagine if your gut is making that much sound, it's probably a little uncomfortable, so wasn't uncommon for her to be a little bit painful. We did draw some blood work, which was in normal limits. Anytime you suspect a mushroom toxicity, you really want to get some baseline blood work, check those liver values, check those kidney values, so that you can then monitor them ongoing. We administered charcoal, which she immediately vomited back up, and then placed a catheter, IV catheter, IV fluids, repeated charcoal overnight, which she held down. Within 24 hours, she was fine, ready to go home, no problems after that. So this was a classic musk green toxicity, ate the little brown mushrooms, vomiting, diarrhea, supportive care, go home. The next patient that we saw was Ghost. He's a 4-year-old male neutered border collie. He was out for a hike and he all of a sudden stood really still, put his head down, put his tail down, and then just started freaking out. So racing, he was running head on into trees. He was running up hills. He was kind of sliding off the trail and the owners were calling him, trying to get his attention, and it wasn't happening. So they literally had to tackle him, get him to the ground, and then carry him out to get to the hospital. So this sudden onset of just crazy neurosigns. They took him to his regular vet first, where he got multiple doses of diazepam, multiple doses of phenobarbital, and they finally gave him xylazine to try and get him to calm down. He was hypertensive, he was hyperthermic, he was, everything was just up and a little bit crazy. The RDVM actually sent him home. They thought they got things under control with the sedation that they gave him and sent him home. He continued to not do well at home. He was really ataxic. He would try and stand, and he was falling and slamming his head onto the ground. When he came into us, he had a lot of sores on the inside of his mouth from where he was just biting his lip. He really was not appropriate. So when he got to DoveLewis, he was ataxic. He was paraparetic, so he really couldn't control his limbs. He didn't know where he was. He was definitely mentally inappropriate. He was showing signs of aggression. And he was vocalizing inappropriately. So just screaming at nothing, and then he'd be quiet for a few minutes, and then, you know, seemingly nothing would set him off to this inappropriate vocalizing. We did a CBC chem, which was within normal limits. So we placed an IV catheter, we started IV fluids. He was having a lot of muscle tremors and flailing, vocalizing. So what we ended up doing was putting him on a propofol CRI. And we would put him on propofol, have him intubated and on oxygen, and we'd leave him that way for a couple hours, and then we'd try and back down off the propofol, and he would start tremoring, and we were worried it would progress to seizures, so we turned the propofol back up again. We did do an enema on him, which is one of my favorite things to do on these toxicities, and we did get mushroom pieces that came out with the enema. So we knew that he had ingested mushrooms. We were assuming it was the psilocybin mushroom, so he did get into the hallucinogenics out on this hike. So when we saw the mushroom pieces in the enema, we also decided to do gastric lavage. We did get some leaves out on the gastric lavage, so we knew that he had been out eating things on this hike. We added a dexmedetomidine CRI onto his propofol CRI just to keep everything quiet. After about 24 hours post-admission to DoveLewis, we were able to turn off all of his drugs and let him wake up. If you remember, most of the hallucinogenic mushrooms, the side effects last 12 hours. His went a little bit longer, and that may have been because they sat in his stomach for so long, and he just continued to recirculate that toxin. But after 32 hours, he was awake, eating, holding food down, and ready to go home. So this was a pretty dramatic case, but we were able to just anesthetize him for a day. He woke up and did fine. So the last case is Mack. He's a 9-year-old male neutered little terrier. He was at the cemetery with his owner and doing something under a tree. And when she got home, he started vomiting. She saw little mushroom pieces in the vomit, and he also started having diarrhea. The diarrhea quickly progressed to hematochezia, just bright red blood, and he had a really painful abdomen. And so she brought him right into DoveLewis. She was smart, brought the mushrooms with her so that we could try and have somebody identify them. When he got to the hospital, his respiratory rate and his heart rate were the same, and his respiratory rate was 24. So he was severely bradycardic. He had a low blood glucose, and he had a severely elevated lipase, and that was the only thing wrong with his blood work. So we gave this dog atropine for his bradycardia. We provided glucose for him, and we gave him glucose in his IV fluids and just supported him that way. He had a really dull mentation. We did call in a mycologist, or we called a mycologist, took pictures and sent them to her, and she identified these mushrooms as musk green mushrooms, so just the little brown mushrooms that he was eating. He had a really severe response to this toxin. Again, most of these patients are sick for, 12 hours. That German Shepherd had the same type of toxin. She went home within a day. This dog, obviously a lot sicker, and his ALT started climbing. We continued supportive care. Atropine is the antidote for musk green, so we continued to give him atropine to try and keep his heart rate up, and that did help, get his heart rate up into the 80 to 100 beats per minute range. His GI signs continued for days, so we'd really struggled with trying to get him to stop vomiting. The diarrhea continued, hematochezia continued. He was on antibiotics for that. What probably happened with him is he had a breakdown of his gut mucosal barrier, and then kind of had a SIRS response. So he was a pretty sick guy. He did spend about 80 hours in the ICU, but was eventually ready to go home. So just because most patients have this, 12 to 24 hour response to this musk green, most of them do really well. Looking at a patient like this, he did have a really dramatic response. He did need much more intensive monitoring, but with supportive care, he was able to go home. So his liver values eventually normalized, everything went well, and he did great. So the take home about mushrooms: assume every mushroom that you see out in the wild is bad until proven otherwise. So those of you who are skilled at hunting mushrooms and like to use them to cook, that's great. A lot of these toxins are removed by cooking. So if you're doing that properly and you're used to that, that's great. But I still would not trust my dog to find mushrooms out in the wild and eat them. Early detection is the key. So even in the spring, summer, and fall months, which are big months for mushrooms, if clients call and there's been acute onset of really dramatic vomiting and diarrhea, asking them if there could be any exposure to mushrooms, because getting on top of it early, decontaminating, that's the key to treating them. Identification: if there are mushrooms in the yard, have the owners bring them in. Don't put it in a Ziploc bag. They want to wrap it in a moist paper towel. Mushrooms are mostly water, and so if they dry out, they just look like little gray pieces of schmutz, and nobody's going to be able to identify that. So wrap it in a damp paper towel. Find out a mycologist in your area who you can call. In our experience, they're very, very happy to help us. Who calls a mushroom identifier with an emergency? They get really excited to help. And so we do have numbers of a couple people that we can call. So have that on board so that you can get a hold of these people as you need them. Monitor their liver values. Again, with most of the patients that we saw, their liver values remain normal. But if you do have a patient and you suspect Amanita toxicity, those liver values will go up pretty quickly. So you want to be on top of that. And then supportive care. That's really all you can do. Do as much decontamination as you can. Enemas, don't forget the enemas. That can be really helpful to get rid of that that's sitting in the GI tract, kind of help that move along, and then support them until they can get better and go home. And that's what I've got on mushrooms. Thanks for your participation in our toxins bracket.